What we can think is, like, when we talk about content delivery, what comes to your mind, and we can structure this kind of based on synchronous, asynchronous, that would be one way of doing, and also like control delivery, and or you have a traffic control delivery, those things you can do.
That's true. Satish just told me that he was told that we don't necessarily have to stick to just these questions, but generally the main topic header, content delivery and usage, both, they are very pretty important issues, and I think all of you have experience on that. Maybe we can start in parallel while people sign up, we can start a round of introduction. So Satish is the best person to start because he's one of the rapporteurs. Why don't you start from there?
Hi, Satish here from Microsoft Research, based in Bangalore. Glad to be here.
I'm Professor Gohuma, director of TechCube.
I see.
Kerala.
Nice to meet you, sir. Yeah. Go ahead, you can see.
Yes.
Excuse me. Yeah.
So, you can see. From Liquid. We are English product, technology based English product for the Indian market. We do a lot of content development for overseas clients.
Liquid.
Liquid.
Dr. Prasad, I'm a professor at ET, National Institute of Data Science. I teach use of professional data in
Dr. Shantu Sriram from Shastra University.
What subject do you teach?
I take network security. I'm in the School of Computing.
I'm Srinivasan Gopi from the Department of Technical Education, Government of Karnataka.
Myself, Manoj, basically administrator from State Civil Services, Himachal Pradesh.
I'm Dr. Kamalesh, basically a computer science professor. Presently, I'm working as a professional special officer at e-learning in the Special Technical University.
You guys are the first group that did the pilot for Microsoft.
Yeah. Ajay Bora, I'm from Credila, it's an HDFC related company, and we fund the programs, we fund courses and education, including the Western Learning Program and studies, regular courses for studies in India and studies abroad.
I'm Anup Pure, experience for agriculture.
Yes, you gave the talk, sir, so that was you didn't need to be introduced. There's a panel discussion tomorrow, which will also be interesting.
I don't know whether it will be still. There are some question marks. But we are 2006 born.
I'm Aisha
Chandra, I'm working with the Planning Commission and Tarun Arora, co-founder of a company called Nimbus, which is a cloud based platform for researchers.
I'm Mohan Parikar, professor of library and information science at EGO, and I have been handling the SAKSHA program since 2006 and associated with the LMEICT since 2006.
That's wonderful. So we have inputs for you too, So my name is Leena Bajaj, I'm a physicist by training, high performance computing and computer security used, networks used to be my area, but for the last 4 years I've been working for a public policy think tank, Observer Research Foundation. I went there to try to understand why is it so hard to fix higher education in India, why is it taking so long. So it's been a very interesting learning experience, understanding policy, how it's rolled out and you know, what are the impediments. But I also spent 3 years at IIT Bombay in Crescent, which is how I've known through the people. So that's it. So we're ready. We have a new joinee?
No.
He's a cameraman.
Okay, all right. I'm
walking with the camera in front.
Yeah. So I guess we decided that we didn't need to stick to any particular thing, but just to get the discussion going, let's try to answer this question that, you know, also because Mr. Kavit Kumar is familiar with DTH, that dedicated education channels and broadband connectivity are the main modes of content delivery, and soon 50 DTH channels will also be available. So, you know, various MOOC platforms like edX, Coursera are also becoming popular. We're also establishing huge bandwidth for these purposes. How do we ensure that these are effectively used? What is the trade-off between coverage versus effective use? Would anybody like to go first to make a comment?
Okay, so I am from this industry, e-learning industry, for the last 19 years.
Yes.
And the thing that I've seen, e-learning hasn't worked till date. And there are reasons for why it has not worked. Right? One, I think the foremost reason that it has not worked is student stickiness or student motivation to learn in a completely pure online mode, right? Some has not worked out in the past. Lack of FaceTime, teacher connect, I think that was the secondary thing. And third, I would say absence of a back channel, which is through learning analytics, improvement in the program. So the courses were created once and then forgotten, right? So I think these are going to be top three reasons why e-learning has not worked. And precisely the reason why we are seeing a lot of excitement on the MOOC side, right? So when we say MOOC, obviously, and the point that I have to mention here, coverage versus effective use. So the challenge that it throws up is you are now training 10,000 students or a lakh students. Training 40 students was a challenge. How will you handle 10,000 students at one go, right? So these three points which I have mentioned, student motivation and stickiness, MOOC in edX and Coursera has handled in some form through, I would say, relevant faculty lectures. People adore those faculty, that's why they go there, students go there and so there is a faculty pool in those lectures. They can interact and they have to grade their peers. So each Coursera student has to compulsorily grade 5 other students if they want to grade themselves. So there is a hook for grading, and that also puts in a lot of interaction among students. So that has worked on that side.
Would somebody from academia like to respond to that? I think there are more reasons than that, right? Go ahead,
See, they have told two things here. One, DTH. And second is the internet-based technology. There are two different technologies. So the satellite, the internet. I started my career as a professor, assistant professor in engineering college, VTU. Where I was made the whole VTU, the reduced coordinator. VTU had the reduced program. ISR was given as a frequency band, two-way channel. So only university we are given, been given in entire India, two-way channels. Kerala has been given and they are not using it. They are using one way. That is, once they deliver, people at the other end will receive and they go home. But
only here is 2 weeks. They can ask questions, they interact with it. I started my teaching career in the engineering college in 1997. The research program started in 2003 after launching the satellite. I was mainly coordinator of my engineering college. University is spending around 12, 13 crores. The revenue is, our revenue university, e-learning revenue fees is from 18 crores as of today. Now I am a special observer. The last part of the question is how do you ensure that these effectively used? The big room was delegated in, was told by the Vice Chancellor and Registrar people to allot, room was allotted, every equipment was supplied, people maintained etc. But the college authorities and the faculty members did not allow the students to go and use it. Tell me, how do you use it? The reason is, most of the colleges, engineering college, what you're speaking, generating revenue to the engineering college are affiliated colleges. Their ranking is done based on how many students passed out this objective-based learning methods. How many passed out, how many got a job, how many cleared gate, how many. So the teachers are put pressure, how many. So this all these programs in the colleges work from 9 to 5, where in most of the cities they have to escape by there because of the traffic system. Even today, I am a special officer there. We deliver content. The past 3 months, 4 months, the content delivery has stopped by the satellite method because they are Government of Karnataka, they have not made the hub engineer tender. Just for that reason, just for not being 2 4 lakh tender, it has been stopped. So I am, why actually my, this group, I want some other group, I intended to this group. I want to know whether I can deliver the content timely along with my ISRO people. ISRO says that go with some company, only company which supplies routers, other things to the thing. And I am, we are not able to buy them, we don't know how to, what is the MRP of that? State government tells me that you have to do tender and they say that it's a unique product and my auditors say that no, nothing, you have to do tender.
See, these are the kind of things that we can actually make a recommendation to MHRD. Mm-hmm. That there is a way that they can actually negotiate with a panel of vendors and fix what's it called, unit rate, no?
Zero,
there's some name for it. And then, say that, you know, rate contract, that irrespective of who buys from where, they should get it within this price band, if not the exact price. So these are specific recommendations we can write. So that's what you're trying to say.
The 50 channel you are telling.
DTH.
Sir?
I'll
I'm interested in that.
One thing is, acceptability is also required. If you open up these things, we have different platforms. We ask these teachers to teach here. These platforms are available, but see, acceptability, they are not accepting. See, only 5% by the teachers. We have seen.
I have to continue.
From
very important thing is
that. From Chandigarh, we have informed the teacher that these are the things available, but from inside, acceptability. They don't want to change themselves.
Yeah.
They don't want to add those contents.
No, so then let's go step back 1 minute just to understand one thing. See, there are universities and there are colleges, right? And because the universities conduct the exams, the colleges are not free to teach what they want because it will be eventually the universities conducting the exams. So the university has a complete handle on how the student is evaluated. Students are very clever. They will only do what they need to do because that's their survival, right? So then if the university says that, you know, XYZ, you know, and this is how we will examine, and it doesn't matter which mode you teach, or here's the infrastructure, if you want to use it and you don't use it, you're still finding that colleges don't want to use it. Is that what you're saying?
Two things are there. First, delivery of content, not examination. So here, first, what you have discussed is only the delivery of content. Don't come to the examination. Examination is different.
See, no. So I ask this question because I want to understand it myself. What are we saying? Are we teaching the regular class content in online mode? Because, you know, the perception is that if you're going online, you're trying to teach external students. If those external students are also taking the same exam, then it's one kind of answer. And if they're taking different exams, it's one kind of answer. So I just want to know what are we talking
here
about?
The question is,
who are the students?
The delivery of the content. If the contents are not delivered, there is no question of examination.
To whom? I'm asking to whom?
See, there are only two people. There are two customers or what you can end users. So, the faculty and the teacher, the students.
But students on campus or students outside?
On campus.
On campus.
That's why
off campus methods are very much challenged. Use mobile, let them go to URL, let them log in. And it should be made as a part. See, you know, NTPL, NPTEL, a lot of lots of money has been poured into it. But it's now, we'll listen that now Indian students are not using. Indian money is spent for some foreign students.
No, so we should understand this question. This question is asking something very, very important. See, it has brought DTH channels as well as MOOC platforms into the question. See, so I just want to make sure that we all understand the same question.
Unless the institutions, the private institutions, or the institutions, or the school, teachers cooperate, it is not possible. And I was in Karnataka State University as director. I thought of changing the method of learning, etc. Faculty were against because they lose. Because in open university only 10% of the teaching is done, but our 600 extra they are giving, they are going to lose. They did not allow this way of content delivery methods. And in spite of that,
yeah, I will actually answer. Okay.
Yeah.
And it's experience I'm telling, and the question. Okay. And second thing is this online examination also the teachers protested because they will lose 20 rupees per script.
So I can give the money.
No,
this is the money separate. So it's not mixed up. I mean, there are different ways to handle it.
Want the oppose for the online examination?
No. There are different ways to handle it. So it's not.
I think what is, in fact, maybe because two things came up. One was saying that e-learning has failed. It has not taken off. The other one is talking about the satellite based technology because, in fact, it depends a lot on the teacher. How the teacher is able to engage the learner. In fact, from our experience at Delhi, what happens that with the big, because in Ignu, you know, we had the Gyanadarshan and we were having some activity. And what happened, in many cases, people were complaining that we just speak to the camera because there is no one on the other end. So we talk about interactivity and there is no way of knowing whether people are attending or not. Whereas in case of the e-learning thing, at least you can take some kind of an attendance and see where people are there. So that is one part.
We have two-way channel, I'm telling you. Two-way channel.
Yeah.
We have attendance, we have camera. Other party is also seeing what they are doing.
No, but then the problem is that the teacher is not able to engage the learner. So that is the how do you prepare the teacher, that is the most important. And I think that comes as a recommendation.
Can I suggest something? What I suggest is, you have a lot of points to discuss, let's say about 10 points. Say that you will devote at least so much time for each of the topics. So once the time is over, then you might, even if you don't come to the conclusion,
right.
You have to move on. You cannot spend all the time on, because not everybody is interested in every point. So point is taken, note it down, go to the next one. If you have time, you can come. Is that okay? I think if you do that.
But I think we need to give chance to all, because there are many.
Correct, I understand. But what I am saying is you have some planning also to do. That's all.
Question is that we are asking for effective use. Actually, the very use itself is very low in the delivery of it. Conventional teacher is the deliverer. Still, he would like to hold on saying that I am the deliverer, don't go to the content through online or whatever the usual. The capturing by the teachers. Question is that can we make a provision in the content saying that okay, so many hours e-content should be given in a class?
Yeah, making it mandatory may be something.
That's
right.
Yes. Nothing
wrong with that. That comes as a
solution you are asking. Mandatory in the form of the accreditations, what they are doing, whether they have e-learning classroom. They have attendance, how many hours of that?
But Kannan, you are
part
here.
Of that was
so I want you, since you guys have written this question, I want you to clarify the scope of this question. Because you see, this question is very important, set the stage for all of the others. If you are talking about using DTH channels, if you are talking about using new MOOC platforms, then it's not about switching over from traditional classroom teaching into e-learning. It is about adding more students.
Blending.
So
actually,
that's
yeah,
what I
no, it is. It is actually we are still in the nascent stages. Right now, all the discussion in government meetings is: can we give something like 10% of the weightage to students who go to undergo these? So we are beginning only in a small way, but we want to give. So even in the allowing students to take courses through distance learning. MOOCs and so on and so forth.
And get credit for the courses for what they're doing.
This is the thinking and how to accommodate that. So sooner or later, this is going to come.
No, that's separate.
That's a separate question, yeah. This is why we the definition of this question is not
bandwidth resources or what?
So the okay, last one. Sorry for not reading.
Hold on.
I'm the one who wrote this. Coverage
that's
means.
That's why I asked for clarification.
No. I was finishing. I got up early in the morning.
I can imagine.
To finish it. And then they were calling. We are ready to cycle, you know, print and so on.
Yeah.
Okay, coverage means one is, so for example, one is whatever methodology we have, however imperfect it is, make it available to everybody and start using it. That is coverage. We want to cover everybody. That is coverage. The other one is to say, I will take one, do a pilot, thorough pilot, make it very good, then I will make it available. So in that second one, what happens is you can go on doing pilots. You'll never reach other people. So that is what I meant. What is the trade-off? When do we break it and say, make it available? One of the things that we have, for example, we have done our gross enrollment ratio. Now what we are saying is, we have increased the number from 15 to 23, okay? But quality is not good. Let us now concentrate on quality. So we have done it, coverage first and then quality. So what do we do in this? That is the question.
No, that's right, because I was confused, so that's right. So let's, for a moment, let's, I'm sorry, go ahead. I actually haven't understood who is this 95 classes or students, why should I need it? Why, I mean, are you saying that I have a college or a university, I have a class, somebody is teaching? Faculty is teaching students sitting in this class or somewhere else.
So we have the DTH expert here.
I was in the DTH, okay. I dropped out. That's the purpose. With the purpose, I dropped out. And that's the question I'm asking today. I mean, I've been.
So hold on. No, Professor Ray.
This is definitely
the
most exciting
thing. No. The problem is if you allow Professor Ray to But the answers that you didn't get in MHRD, are you hoping to get here?
I do not, I do not agree with that, that's why I dropped out. So what I said, this is, you just make a note, I'm saying, leaving out whether it is, I have not understood who is it for. No, Professor Ray, we may not know the answer, these are certain things, no, no, already, he's planned, he was there, no, no, hold on, he may not be able to explain that. So we just say that many people question this move, and then we go to the next one. Try and understand my question, my question is, DTH has been planned, is being installed, classroom level. There must be some reason written out somewhere. Who is this DTH for?
It is for students.
Which students? Are they students in the classroom? I am aware of the DTH.
Students at home probably. See, earlier Kanan mentioned that synchronous, people like synchronous because they like the helicopters. So these are for students in the home.
Yeah. So those are not full time students, am I right?
Maybe full time also.
In that case, what are they doing at home?
So that's why I said you should time for each question. Let me tell you why. Because right at the beginning, we still started Sam.
I tried to quote at BPT, Bishu Patnaik Technical University, IIT Kharagpur, and a third university, exactly the same thing. After 2 years, I realized it's not workable. Because if students are sitting at home, they're not attending class. If students are attending class, when do they do this?
So I think it might be for you, like, you know, the
Let me answer. I didn't realize you're sitting there. So, to begin, after you're looking at two set of students, one is whom we are trying to give the classroom license. For example, think of 10 lakh students who are doing this chartered accountancy. So chartered accountancy, ICFI is our body, and those students don't have any classroom issue. Open university students,
they don't have any class visits.
People
agree. So the one set of students, company secretaryship. So we can think of many areas. So one area is that where students don't have a classroom experience, and we want to provide this classroom experience. That is one set. Second area which you are looking at is remedial teaching. I have completed my BTech. I want to appear for KTech. I am teaching somewhere, sitting at home, I'm working somewhere, but I want to add that additional bit which makes me whatever So the remedial teaching part of it can be put in this BTech.
So I think we'll stop there because, you know, see, the thing is, I just want to make a general comment. See, these kind of things are infrastructure. So when you build the infrastructure, you don't quite know how people will use it. They will find innovative ways to use it. So we won't confuse the infrastructure with usage.
Sure.
Let's wait for, we'll figure out the
modalities. But I think content level and usage is the question, topic of the day.
No, only we'll come back to it because Tanil wants to leave and
In fact, now that you're saying, when IIT Bombay Gestures was built, apparently very senior official, I don't remember who it was, government or whoever, said, why did you build such a big guest house? You need only two rooms. And anyway, that is the infrastructure part.
In
the main talk, it was talked about why 15? Because the idea was, at one point it was discussed, mechanical engineering, 4-year degree program mechanical engineering has so many courses. Hundred years they have to be built. You're talking about completely different things. People who are not a regular students. It's a very different game when this message is not more. The message itself is questioning.
Okay, let me give you another answer. You questioned our synchronous education.
No.
Yeah. You did. No. You said you should only do.
Yeah, of course.
You cannot be asking.
Synchronous should be followed by synchronous.
So what I'm saying is, here we are not here to. We could ask some questions. We may not know the answers to some other, right? Not able to convince you. But I think we should just note them down and move on, because there are many things to discuss. That's all I'm saying.
And I think the other.
Okay? And who knows? Maybe after 2 years, we may be in a position to answer this, or maybe after 2 years, we'll say that. We tried it, it didn't work out, let's close it. So that is okay.
First, the teachers has to make compulsory to, suppose I'm teaching a course on embedded system, or operating system, I have to go through that online content first, then only I will appreciate and then I will make my students do.
So we come back to that point If you could just allow anyone and everyone who has a solution in mind, because problem statement everyone knows, I think, and then at least all the solutions are there, and that itself gets you 10 points on the page. I think what we have to remember, is that MHRD is seeking inputs from academics, educators, stakeholders in education. So we have to be responsible when we give the inputs. So we'll come back when we have, if we have more point time, we will come back for a free for all, then we can take up more points. But I'd like to move on because Kannan would like to clarify some questions, okay? So shall we move straight to the fourth one and then come back and do two and three? Let's do that. It doesn't matter really which order. You want to do number four, right? Go ahead with the fourth one.
Yeah, so I will just say third, fourth, and fifth. I'm sure that Professor Ray will agree with some of these things. Third one says that teaching 10,000 people simultaneously, that is synchronous program, we have had reasonably good experience. There are some issues in that, we can come back to that. Okay? Now let me go to point four. Because actually I want to go to point five. I'm making the.
The fourth is very interesting, sir.
Yeah, fourth one is asynchronous. Third one is synchronous that we have had experience. We also have experience with the fourth one, which is asynchronously training large number of people simultaneously. It can happen, for example, I told you in spoken periods, we are going to train, we are going to conduct 10,000 workshops this year. And so that is also okay, but then it works mainly for skill-based kind of learning. For example, asynchronous method, I'm not sure whether it will work completely, whether I can teach relativity or you know something like that through self-learning method. Okay, some extra work has to be done. So whatever it is, now I want to talk about point number five, blended learning, where I'm proposing, is it possible for us to blend the two, mix the two, that is the synchronous method of delivery and then also the asynchronous method. What if, and one of the problems we have in massive education is that the quality goes wrong. So the proposal that I'm going to make will actually make a pitch that you can increase the number and also simultaneously increase the quality. That is the reason why I'm making all this pitch. Okay, the point is the following. How do we approach this is for whatever thing that we want to teach, make available to the best extent possible videos and so on. It could be 10 minutes, it could be 1 hour, it could be a mix of all this, it could be learning material, whatever it is, make it available and then conduct a test for people who want to participate in the synchronous mode. So this will definitely work for teacher training kind of a thing, people who want certificates or there are high stake, namely I want to get marks, good marks. So even to participate in this program, I am saying, suggesting that there be an entrance test. And of course, we should make available the testing mechanism and so on, lot simpler, unlike GATE, unlike JEE, for the students. Could be students, it could be faculty, whatever. So then we say, only people who score, let's say, at least 20% of 20% marks in this, and cutoff is very low, only those people will be admitted for the synchronous program. Right? Initially make available whatever content, let them study, prepare whatever, provide all the help, conduct a test. Test could be like whatever we have been doing or what Agarwal of edX talked about. Build in as much safety measures as possible. Admit only people who score 20% or more for the synchronous. Okay? Now when the synchronous thing comes, it could happen like what Professor Fatak is doing. Do it simultaneously, but make it completely flipped classroom, make it completely problem solving, because they already know enough. I mean they're fast, 20%. Okay. What I'm saying is there are many people in the synchronous program. Now supposing you just open it up, half the people are not interested. Half the people come there, that is without the filtering test, you do a synchronous for 10,000, it is not clear as of now, for example. It's not clear how many people are really interested. My feeling is, okay, half the people, maybe one third of the people. Okay, one third to half the people are really interested. As a result, what happens is you have substantial number of people who are not interested in the program, participating in the synchronous program, along with everybody sitting next to you, spoiling the quality. But supposing you filter them out and say that only people who pass will appear for the synchronous mode, right? Then you can make it problem solving. And for any topic of discussion, there will be 10 views. If there are 100 people, there may be, you may find 20 views. So as the number increases, the same problem will get analyzed from 20 different angles, which will not happen in a small classroom. In a big classroom, people coming from many geographical areas, different backgrounds, people will present different solutions. As a result, the same problem will get analyzed from various angles. Your learning actually may get better in this mode. This is what I am proposing. This is the point number five. So this is the explanation I want. So what do you think about it? Your views.
Go ahead.
No views.
Yeah.
Should we try it out?
No, there are.
Yeah, go ahead.
So my first comment on filtering would be that the entire movement of massive and open, it will go against that philosophy. Any filtering that you bring in, right? Ultimately, it is the merit of the program or the attractiveness or the stickiness of the program, that will get you the learners. And if the program is designed to be sticky, I think that's where the success of MOOC lies. And automatically students who are not participating, they will filter out in the process. But I think we should not introduce any filtering mechanism for a MOOC program.
If I can
give a
one of the things that we are trying to do, the MOOCs that let's say offered by edX or whatever, they don't really look for number. I mean, they would ideally want to increase the number. Whereas the MOOCs that we are trying to do, Professor Fatek is trying to convince, excuse me, vice chancellors and so on, trying to make it part of their program. The idea is to accommodate everybody and make 100% complete. So if you say, then if you object to that, I will call this MOOC something different. What we are trying to do, you might say that, look, you should not even attempt. But I'm saying that there is a need from the, you know, government's point of view. We are putting in so much effort. We would want as many people to participate. We also want to reach out to lots of people. We would want the completion rate to be 90%. So is it okay if you run a big program, MOOCs program, and only 10% complete? Is that okay, or should we put in efforts to increase the number to 50, 60, 70? Let's have a poll on that.
Yes.
Let's have a poll on that first. Let's have a poll on that first.
Can I ask you a question? Yes. What you just suggested, if I understand you right, 100 people join, you take a test, you drop out 80, 20, and those 20 will compete and call that 100% success. Am I right?
No.
You take 100, 80 drop out, 20 stay who have qualified, and those 20 finally complete.
Okay.
And you
okay.
call that 100%.
Okay, oh, hold on. Okay. So I need to point out the difference. The big difference is, if you look at MOOCs, there is a lot of effort that goes in conducting it.
Right.
So I'm not talking about that. My asynchronous program I'm talking about is not MOOCs. It's like spoken tutorial. How am I going to conduct 10,000 workshops this year? How am I going to train 5 lakh people? People are learning on their own. So the effort, please don't combine the MOOCs with this. This is not MOOCs. I'm not talking about MOOCs. I'm talking about synchronous and asynchronous. Asynchronous is where you make with self-learning material made available. Right? It is not MOOCs. It's not MOOCs. I'm not saying use MOOCs to filter, conduct tests. I'm not saying that.
But can I ask a question?
Yes.
See, the commitment to the students to complete, if that's the goal of MHRD, that people who start should complete the course, it will have several other components like credit for the course towards the degree that you are, certification has a very strong impact on whether people complete or not. Today, if 150
there's a whole lot of research and publication, what you're saying.
Yeah.
Certification from an established reputed institution increases chance of completion by several points.
Very low. So,
I'll for example, we saw completion rates on our pilots, I mean, although small numbers, but it was a MOOC, it was an asynchronous course offered, asynchronously. But if you look at the standard completion dates of say for Coursera or edX versus what we got, I think two things work for us from what we saw at least. One is that they providing incentives in terms of certifications or alignment with the school, etc., gets a student a direct buy-in. And he or she puts in an effort, he sees the result of the exam or whatever. That's one. Number two, I think we saw, and I think that's one of the questions here later, is that engagement with the students even through the course, I mean using social media, whatever it is, highlight student of the month or quiz star of the week. Things like that. So those kind of things also help in making sure students feel an involvement of the process and not just an arbitrary face off between a video and what you watch.
Let me share my experience. What happened in a big way, we started our FlexiLearn program. It was nothing but the MOOCs only. So we made our course material available, and with lots of enthusiasm, in a day or two, we had more than 60,000 registration. But at the end of the time, all of them wanted that we want a degree.
Mm-hmm.
That was what happened. And I mean, in that sense, it's not a MOOC there. So it's becoming, e-learning platform.
Yeah.
If I can get right, what you said, goal,
we started somewhere with the kind of concept of MOOC, where you try to filter out the students for quality. And ultimately, when we landed in asynchronous mode of teaching, where the students are downloading and then reading themselves, spoken. So, what is this exactly? Whether the quality, by filtering the students, are we ensuring quality in spoken tutorial also? Because where the student is just downloading, then we need not filter anything. Anyone can study and anyone can give the exam.
Okay, before he answers, let's just take a poll on whether you think, those who think that, like the way Kannan said that, you know, you...
No, but people are not answering. How will they answer the poll? Then we can come back to this later, discuss on that point.
Courses have to be taken in
the analogy to support what you said.
Just one second.
Analogy support. So the product that we run is a live project platform where we go and connect with high quality corporates and tell them that we work with you to flesh out projects which students can work in real time along with their academy schedule, which is a twist on the BTech project format. You're actually doing it along throughout the year versus you're during your summer. So students actually attack smaller problems. They are fleshed out in a manner that's doable and feasible for the students. However, it's amazing, even when the projects are coming from really good companies, the students are dropping out from those projects. We realized that there was a gap, in spite of it being from good colleges, there was a gap between the learning that is expected before they plunge into those projects. They were second year
students.
And we had probably just give them the project via a simple test. But then we did an analogy to what you had said. We opened out a very large set of people and told them that you have to finish this particular short program and then take a test and then you can do the project. It resulted in higher success rates for the projects and completion rates improved. It also improved our understanding of the committed students of the project, because if you have the willingness to take a very short program, not more than like 5 hours, it's a very short program, but the commitment, the learning, and hence obviously for the company, better performance and project completion was higher. So to that extent,
That is precisely what I'm saying, because the synchronous program, or even for MOOCs for that matter, I'm classifying this into two parts. One is something that we can do with almost effortlessly, allow the people to express their views and so on. Then we say that, look, of all of you, only the serious people can come to the next level. That's a lot of work. We will engage with you because you have shown interest. So the filtering thing, I'm talking about absolutely minimum. Because what happens is, I don't know how many of you are from private enterprises. We run mainly with government initiatives. We conduct QIP programs, we conduct CEP programs, Tech Whip and so on. Half the people who come there are not interested. They come only for certificate. And that reduces the overall standard of the whole course. That is the point. And should we not do something about it? Make the entry barrier absolutely low, very low. If you don't like 20%, make it 10%. Doesn't matter. Something self-learning material.
Argument, what will you do with the QIP program?
That's a different thing. So we can ask.
You, go ahead. He's trying to pick a fight with you. I don't know. Go ahead.
Gupta's slides from morning. Practically 75%.
Who's?
I think Anup Gupta.
Thank you.
Practically 75% of the.
Everybody signed, right?
There might be circuit scores. Drop out of after the first place.
But I also want to ask one more question. See, the MOOC effort is very large the first time you run the course, but it starts to improve with time. So, do we really match it with the first effort cost, or do we match it with, take a much longer term view?
Yeah, I think it's a basic question which was raised as to what is the philosophy of a MOOC or whatever initiative that you want to run. What is the basic philosophy of? Now, you want to take it to as large section of the student population as possible, and knowing fully well that, a percentage of them will not be interested. But hopefully over time, as models increase, as engagement increases, as we find better mechanisms, that's what Anup was talking about in his slide, you know, there will be more and more students will be drawn into the pool. Or do we consciously filter it, you know, by intent and say this is the only student that we want to engage? I think philosophically we have to answer that question first before we really, you know, approach.
So, so the point, so the my feeling is that if we, unless we give some guarantee of quality and so on, one of the impediments that is going to come in accepting such large courses from the universities themselves, you yourself will come back and tell me this course is not effective, our students should not join. Our classroom instruction is not better. I am saying here, so I am saying, I have a methodology to ensure even the mass training also is as good. It may even be better. So,
let's have the assessment. The exit assessment be very strong.
Manish, there's a program called the Bits Pilani.
I'm saying let the exit assessment be very strong. And have your stamp on that assessment. So, I think that is a fair way to do it.
Not the MOOC. Since you raised MOOC, MOOC was not the synchronous, the synchronous issue. Since you raised MOOC, suppose 1 lakh or 1 million student joins, and finally maybe 50,000 students complete. What's the problem?
No problem.
No, there is a problem.
Now, what is the problem?
There is a problem because every university, I mean, right now, if I go to any, talk to any director of technical education or any vice chancellor, he will say the biggest problem I have is 40% of the people are failed. That is my biggest problem.
No, we are not talking about that. MOOC is for people who are not in regular institution.
Mainly.
Originally it was devised for that. So if they join, these 50,000 people, 30,000 people, they are the ones who are benefiting. They would not have got any benefit otherwise.
No, I'm saying that I'm talking about a completely different scenario that is going to emerge in India. We are allowing every student to take up to 10%, that such a rule is going to come. Yeah, if that is coming, if such a thing comes, why don't we be open-minded? Why don't we be open-minded? So, do you want people to say, as a result, MOOC is not acceptable for our regular course? Would you want that to emerge?
No, sir, assessment should be strong.
That is going to emerge. No, that is what I'm saying. It is going to be strong.
Strong assessment.
It is going to be strong. As a result, they will fail at the end of one semester. So many people will fail. Let a vice chancellor in this room tell the same thing, express the echo your sentiment.
We are not talking about MOOC.
You are saying synchronous teaching must be preceded by a cutoff.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
I have no problem with that.
Okay, good.
So I'm saying
good, that's all I'm saying.
Can I say? Do I not do that even today? IIT Bombay, any IIT, any incident says this is the cutoff. Join. What's the difference?
That's the reason why I said we want to do it in a much lot easier way. JEE means it's preparation for 5 years. There is a difference. This test may happen all the time. I'm saying cut off mark is 10%.
Actually, we can
diverse. All asynchronous teaching takes place before the university.
So, you finished, sir. Go ahead.
This point is basically for delivery to use.
Delivery.
To whom to deliver? No. And what will happen after delivery? No, the issues have become fourth and second have become main issues for the third year.
I think
the here is that delivery and usage. We are not looking at to whom to deliver.
And how to deliver.
How to deliver. What will happen? No, it's not even that. What will happen after the delivery?
And just think about another thing. Another thing.
Let's go back to BDH.
One second.
This group is meant for delivery.
One second. But think of also, because we are always talking about the learner side. Have you thought about the poor teacher also? What do you expect from the teacher?
What is the context?
100%. What is the delivery? You are expecting the teacher to deliver through DTA, to e-learning.
No. Don't mix them all. What Kannan said, that any synchronous teaching is in my
mind.
I'm not able to sing it. I'm just trying to understand. I think all of us would need to hear.
No, my question that is coming. Can we also talk, why are we talking about blended? Why are we not also talking about convergence? Technology convergence with, in fact, say a single delivery point in multiple formats, multiple...
So that's a complex question. We'll come back to that. Let me just go move on. Question number two, okay? This is pretty important. It says that, is there a need for proper institutional and system level strategies for delivery of content and its usage? Question number two. Despite multiple delivery channels, actual usage of high quality content is somewhat limited. Is there a need for proper institutional and system level strategies for delivery of content and its usage?
I don't refresh this question. See, I'll write the first thing. Despite multiple delivery channels, actual use of high quality content is somewhat limited. Then, instead of putting there, what is the reason for that? Can you ask that? Instead of suggesting a solution, I'll say why is it so?
No, it is talking about institutionalizing the whole thing, like what we have as an institution which can take care of all.
Why are you putting answers in our mouths? Instead of saying that, just put it there and say why is it, then answer the question. Why does it happen? And then answer it. You're now putting the answer in our mouth.
No, so these questions were made up by Kannan and I. So I don't know.
It doesn't matter.
No, so if you want to paraphrase the question and answer it, you can also go ahead. But anybody else before I give it back to
Professor? No, don't give it back to me.
No? You don't want to comment?
This doesn't happen if we can ask ourselves and reason out why does it happen.
There was a time when in the IIT attendance was not compulsory.
Correct.
In the IIT. So there were people who had 20% attendance at the IIT.
Right.
20% attendance at the IIT. I remember one of these guys who went to an interview with IIMs and they asked, you know, your attendance is falling. Mm-hmm. So the guy said the teacher is so bad. Mm-hmm. Right? And in later years, attendance was made compulsory. So I think this is sort of an analogy.
By the way,
yeah. Just
is not compulsory anymore.
I think you're making an important analogy. Yeah.
Right. So if you're going to use that, that's what you're talking about, institutionalizing it. Mm-hmm. I think students attend classes where, irrespective of the teacher saying, I'm not in attendance. Students will come into those classrooms because we are human beings driven to,
drive to learn.
Right, so even at a delivery channel level, if the quality, like Manish said, stickiness, if the quality, the way in which the whole thing is portrayed, and the quality of the MOOCs, well, for example, in the case of MOOCs, earlier there was no quizzes every 10 minutes or 3 minutes, whatever. So there's a whole lot of delivery elements related to improving the quality of, just like a teacher can make a difference. So you can, in the beginning, to get people into the classroom, bring in some institutionalizing like credits and making compulsory in the classroom that this percentage should be, asynchronous or via MOOC kind of platform. But over time, the stickiness is not going to be there if the product is not good. Students can still say, I won't enter that class and I'll just take the exam.
That are coming, which are not sequential, starting with introduction, discussion, it's not that way. So exactly, that point is right. Mm-hmm. One need to engage the people, and then we have the technology. Mm-hmm. But what we are doing is exactly the same.
I think we're too much of that blind channel vision about,
So that's the precise point. Why are we here? We're here because we have to give short-term and long-term recommendations to MHR.
But then
so let's think about it.
For example, Microsoft's MSR Athena, Microsoft Athena, that's an example of someone trying to make MOOCs a little more interesting.
If we are to do a useful thing in this session, it's our wisdom that we have given to the MHR. we may give little reference of this, but this reference may be misleading totally.
Preconceived things
which has already happened. And maybe same people have created the these things then.
Exactly.
But let's give a very basic thought. Synchronous and asynchronous.
Mm-hmm.
We should not fight. This is not good, this is not good. Both have their meanings.
Mm-hmm.
Like asynchronous, first synchronous, it's very typical. Do our syllabuses match? No, they don't match. Do our curriculum match delivery? That means it can never happen in India. Synchronous, you know, 600 universities and so much of, you know, mismatch is there. We cannot bring them at the same platform. July 2nd, this course will be conducted. It's not possible. So, but it has got a meaning at its own. Asynchronous is also important. So, maybe we can blend it is very important.
Mm-hmm.
Blended learning, bring asynchronous. Let the students and teachers first go through that, and let the time in the classroom be used for that, you know, discussion purpose.
Mm-hmm.
Let's not criticize them. Synchronous is not good. Let's give them the method how it should be used in the. Let us perhaps the government will be more happier with such type of, you know, suggestions.
Yeah.
Then criticizing this and this, everything is. And let's understand it's an experiment. Let when Edison invented light bulb, the first lady asked, "What is the use of it?" He didn't know the answer. If anybody is asking what is the use of DJ, probably I will not be able to give the answer. It's a platform, it's a highway.
Yeah.
We have created. What van will run depends on you. What you will put in the van, buffalo or goods or gold, it's up to you. It should not be questions, should not be posed. It's for academics to answer, understand it. And we are sure we will not be having answer in the first day itself.
But I think
this is a part of the system,
yeah,
you know.
Yeah.
And what we have to understand, if somebody is connecting rivers in India, it has got some meaning.
Correct.
If somebody is connecting roads in India, it has some meaning. If somebody is connecting satellites through India, it has got some meaning. Two things I can tell you, I don't know, analysis. A GTH costing per student, we take only 2,75,000 students are there in the country.
Mm-hmm.
Assume only 15% students are using, going to use it. Per year, the government is going to spend for one channel, for the student is 8.72 rupees for one channel 1 year.
Mm-hmm.
It's a midday scheme, one Parle G biscuit 1 day cost for a child.
Mm-hmm.
So perhaps let's not compare it. These are the systems that have to come. Why DTH? 850 channels are there in the country.
Mm-hmm.
You ask Prasar Bharati, they have three objectives, to inform, educate and entertain. Education comes second. Information, there are 115 channels for news. Rest are education, entertainment, non for education. Satellite was first used for its delivery in the first 43 years before in India. For the side experiment was the first country to use satellite for in India. Today we have no use of it.
No, I
let's not mix it. What is the use and how to use it? This is not a question.
No, take
these are platforms. These are the delivery platforms. They are cost effective. They are reaching everybody. 67% population today have television. We don't have to create investment crores of rupees, hundreds of crores, thousands of crores people buy PC.
So we just have to
they
go
are the delivery program. And every house has got. Mother will say to the child, you watch the program,
mm-hmm.
I will forego my serial,
mm-hmm.
because that's going to get you some employment.
Okay.
That's the way the society will change.
Change, yeah.
Let's
let's
give a suggestion to the government how these platforms that we are running are going to be used.
Content. This amazing content that private enterprises are making. But you know, as I sat in this conference, I realized there's so many colleagues, entrepreneurs in business who are not even aware of this, that they can, you know, latch on their content to this, like he said, the highway. And then students can take a choice that I want to learn this concept from, you know, using this content versus that content, because this sounds much more exciting than the other one. So that connect I feel is missing. There is a divide. I mean, it's just not kind of, you know,
I'll just come to you in a minute. I just want to close this thread. What I want to say is that
Professor
Pathak is teaching 10,000 teachers synchronously at 300 centers. If he had DTH, he could probably have...
What a DTH will revolutionize.
Yeah.
If we find out, nothing to criticize, my senior and esteemed colleague,
mm-hmm.
they spend, say, 70-80% money in the transporting these people to there. That money will be saved in DTH.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Why do we need to, why do we transport people? Why do we need to transport people? Let us stay at the home.
So we have to work out the time.
You know, it's not going to be wasted. That's all. That's the response. And not only 10,000. He has 3 years, 1,50,000. 1,50,000 in one day, 1 month. You don't know if he can deliver it.
Correct, correct. That part is well taken. I want to get
back to the point. Numbers now going to give benefit.
Correct.
So let's divide, let's look into those glasses in that way and find out the government what to do.
So in that spirit, I want to start another, a different thread because Uma is here. She said she's part of the Sakshat portal.
Correct.
Now, I want to, so, and you said that private sector has a lot of very good content. I think we need to think about how there is content everywhere. You know, people say there is no content, but I don't agree at all. There is a lot of content, there may be gaps, and there may be small, there may be much smaller amount of content in Indian languages than there is in English, all right? But at the end of the day, we have to find a way to gather all this content together, tag it somehow, make it available to a student who is looking for it. If I'm looking for a BTech second year course, level course in mechanical engineering, I should be able to find it, you know, on Sakshat. So do you want to comment a little bit on what Sakshat is doing now so that we can give suggestions?
Sakshat has to bring it. Mainly when we started it was meant for K to 20. So we started in the school level, had 11th and 12th course content put in. And then what happened, projects were happening, so that consolidation never happened. So projects are hosted in, EdTutor is happening separately, then Spoken Tutor is in their own server. So what is needed now is actually putting them together and making it available. That's what the learning also from, JS also talked about it. So there is a plan, in fact, that now we will be separating out, because what was happening in Sakshat was more of an administrative thing, more related to the revenue as a secretary. So two different websites are coming. One will be just administrative for NMEIC purposes, which has the MIAs and everything. The other one will be something for the teachers and students only. So Sakshat in future will be something which will be a content repository where we pool everything together. And in fact, what you are talking about, indexing, tagging, that's what we are talking. In fact, in the meetings also, we have been discussing. We go in for some standard metadata and all those things that we have. We can relate them. And mapping with curriculum is a big job that needs to be done, so that is in the process. So that we will be doing, in fact.
But it should take 5 years.
Yeah.
I think my biggest complaint about the NME ICT is that.
What is the problem?
Yeah.
We are educators, we know ICT how it works. If we have keywords, if you have meta tag, that will solve the issue. We have never seen. So if we have to make compulsory whosoever producing content, let me give keywords, let me give meta tag. This is the biggest asset. Automatic data will be created. Otherwise, once you create a content and he doesn't look into this, we are finished. That is gone to the black. Nobody will look into that. Nobody will can ever trace it. These are the recommendations which will come from us. Make it compulsory. Whosoever you are running
board,
content creation, any government money is going, ask him to give keywords,
Just one point there, when we talk about massive amount of content, see, so just a comment on content. I agree that there is a lot of content, but not necessarily content is top class 100% quality content, right? So the need of the hour is to put this content into a Wikipedia type of a platform where community and people from all walks of life can comment on content and let the best content come out by itself. I think that's the need of the hour, because putting content that has not worked in the past in a newer platform may not work.
I think that's when she said that, so the suggestion for that is the following, that you have ratings.
And Wikipedia type of platform. Let community rate it and create the
content. Nobody reads it, or I get a rating of zero.
So that's what I'm saying, Wikipedia type of format, so the bad content moves out automatically of the system.
I think that's an important thing, that maybe we should even put in the elements of tagging, and certainly there should be rating and there should be free flowing comments that are captured, so that, just like YouTube, we do it all the time, right?
YouTube, Wikipedia,
Amazon.
Amazon, we kind of find related content, so it should not be difficult now. Today we have usage models, which can need to be absorbed into Sakshat. So Satish, will you just write that down, that that's a specific recommendation?
Yes.
Yes, like I had mentioned in the morning when I was talking about pedagogy, 200 courses, undergraduate, civil, electrical, mechanical, electronics, computer science, and chemical engineering, six disciplines, 25 courses each, last year's discipline, 200 courses are being developed under this project. Multiple faculty members are involved. Each course is a 40
What, NPTEL or something else?
Yes. Pedagogy project.
Most people don't know about it. Each course is a 40-hour duration. Let me call the course, if not course, it's 40 lessons equivalent. What this project does, it says, if you say the name of a course, you just mentioned a course, the course objective is written, and course is divided into module and unit. Module objectives are written, and unit objectives, using Bloom's taxonomy and all range of Having done that, the faculty says to be able to achieve this objective, it is assumed there will be self-learning. First assumption is self-learning. Then the references, what you call the content tag is provided. The faculty, a team of three faculty members, will write down to be able to learn this lesson, lesson number one. If you go to this book, you read this book, it's not necessarily a content of the website. It's not a 10-list document. It may even be a book. This chapter, this page, or this page to this page, or this website, or this thing. And the best ones chosen by faculty of the mostly IITs and NITs are involved, or Bethlehemia beginners. So they prepare that. It is done by three people, it is reviewed by two other more people, additional two other senior faculty from all over the world. Then that references go. If you look at the site, I can give you the reference. At the moment it's not open because it's full of all kinds of content. Once that is done, then it gets changed, as you just said. Then after that, the whether somebody has actually been able to achieve that or not by reading on their own or in groups, there are test problems given. Large number of test problems given, if answers are hidden, faculty can allow the students to look at it or use it in the class. And then a two-page summary is given. For 200 courses, 8,000 hours, 200 times 40 years. 200 times 40, 8,000 hours of work. And each of these curriculum document, it is not a document, a curriculum document is about 400 pages wide. Each curriculum document. So what you do in a half page is about nearly 300 to 400 pages of it. Because the problems are given, the solutions are given, the references are given. The best part of it, it gets anything which is not good, it gets dropped out. With time. And commented from the whole world. Not just the students, not just the faculty, anywhere in the world, it gets dropped out. Automatically it gets dropped out. And the best survive. Better than that, the students themselves, the future students, will say, no, this is a better example, no, this is a better site, automatically builds up. So that's what you're just basically saying.
Yeah, I think that's the
point. But that, the difference is not tagged. It is clearly marked by experienced faculty who has been teaching the subject, recognized the best faculty in the country, at team of two or three. So it's not anybody picking it. But with time, within 2 years, the faculty who originally generated it, if it's successful, none of his material will remain. It will be replaced by better one.
Yeah.
So now we have about 20-25 minutes. I want to ask you people about this list. We said we don't necessarily need to stick to this list. We can look at other things. So is there any burning issue that anybody would like to comment on in this context? Okay, start.
Yeah. Madam moderator, 8 o'clock, we want some very concrete suggestions to come out of this group.
No, but you see what we did.
No, so this is only a very illustrative.
So content delivery and usage. So we are trying to focus on that. So go ahead. Yeah.
So I think just a comment on the entire thing. Right. So I think the goal of learning, I think, is ultimately personalized learning for all. If we can move in that direction, I think we are in the right direction. That you have personalized learning path for each learner, ultimate goal. Right? And I think with MOOCs, we have taken a step in that direction. Right? Where we are saying that yes, maybe for 10,000 students there are some different paths, not same paths, but at least they can talk to their peers, they can do it at their own time, they can do it at their own pace, they can also look at other materials on the net. So I think we are moving in that direction. The conception of MOOCs, it started way back in 2005 or 2006 with CMOOCs, which was called connectivist MOOCs, yeah. Right? So an expert teaching another expert who is teaching another expert, and that topic built on itself. But obviously that is not going to work in a university system, so you need structure and stuff. So they transform into current.
I'd like to add to what you're saying. See, Mr. Pawan Agarwal asked for recommendations.
Yeah.
I want to say the following. Let's see, there are many things that are fundamentally different in India than it is in
right.
the US.
Yeah.
Okay. First of all, they're very network savvy, penetration 85% plus. You know, faculties, technology savvy, and all of that. And also, you know, so there, when they do a MOOC, worldwide people can take, most of us, second time learners, what I call second, third, you know, lifelong learners are taking their MOOCs, okay? But in India, what I'm understanding is that, you know, government is trying to assess whether spending on technology will help them reach education to many more students than they normally can, right? For in that scenario, I think,
and raise the quality part.
And also raise the quality. So you want to extend reach and you want to extend quality, right? In that scenario, the thinking of universities and their relationships with their colleges becomes very important, because one subject we touched on is the issue of why should the student be motivated to study if he or she doesn't get any credit for that, all right? Why should the faculty teach it if he or she doesn't get, is not allowed to evaluate? So I'd like some of the academics here to comment on the university-college relationship, the lack of autonomy, the lack of you know, freedom to evaluate the students, and what that has to say for online courses. What that has to say for the behavior of students in terms of taking online courses and dropping it, passing through it, and so on.
Yeah, just
so,
one point. You know,
yeah.
I think I did say, you know, recommendations. Actually, you know, many of these areas, you cannot have straightforward recommendations
no.
all alone.
Correct.
Changes, you know, in the area of content delivery have to happen at various layers.
Correct.
And we may not be able to get all answers in one conference.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that is.
True.
So even if we basically see what are the sub-issues in the broad topic of content delivery,
mm-hmm.
and how sub-issues have been further analyzed,
mm-hmm.
to identify what are the key, you know, challenges in addressing that, roadblocks, or what are the opportunities in that. And so we move forward, you know, through these events we move forward. When we put together, I mentioned a Mumbai statement or Mumbai
declaration,
you know, so we should say that we have thought through it very carefully.
Mm-hmm.
And content delivery, these are the various issues which have to be addressed at the policy level, at the institutional level, at the regulatory agencies level, etc., etc.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so some such statement of would be helpful.
Correct.
To move
so
forward.
So we've been trying to stay.
So whether we are taking the course on online mode or regular semesters, it should be uniformly recommended. Actually, the MHRD should. See that it is done like that. For example, Karnataka State University gives 2 MBA program. They have put a master card seal, MBA, then another is online. And usually that online is looked down upon.
We need a policy on e-learning which is not.
Degree is a degree. Whether they take it online, offline, or some other blended, degree is a degree.
Yeah, so we put it out as a recommendation, they will have to deliver, he can't sort of answer on behalf of the government.
Another thing that was like, in fact, when you talk about the freedom of teachers, in fact, that is absolutely necessary.
See, here, people must take care, have taken part on developing content or delivering content. 99% of the faculty members have not taken part in development and delivery.
Yeah.
They don't appreciate.
So without training the teachers, I think, there's no point of talking about delivery.
Okay,
that's
Mr. Flanagan said that whenever you want to create a substantial change in the behavior of a human being, you have 3-4 different kinds of people. One is the early adopters, they don't care, they're wild, they just want to try anything new, right?
right? And they are the ones who others watch and, you know, kind of watch and wait, and they are the ones who, there are others who will watch and wait, and the third are the ones who are the pessimists who think it's anyway going to fail. Now, to get in the watch and wait, I don't believe the pessimists ever really come around to it, or if they do, it's going to be a long time later. The watch and wait people are normally who wait for real strong indicators, like, for example, people who did the program, you know, got a better job, or people who did the program got better grades. So it's not for the people who do the program, it's more for people who don't do the program that, you know, this made a difference. So if the university system can give a grade up, it's not even equalizing, a grade up for having done the program through you know, online means, you would really kind of get droves of people going that way. Whenever something is mandated, yes, there is acceptance, but when that goes beyond just mandate, but incredible or reasonably higher form of reward, you will see people moving towards that, especially the people sitting on the fence. And they are normally a large middle block.
Also, if you keep the assessment same, right, the assessment that happens in a normal lecture class and the MOOC, and you proctor that MOOC assessment, then what's the issue in giving the same degree? Right. As long as you have passed that assessment test.
So you've already said some ifs, so.
Right.
So
that's I think this adoption, as far as the products are concerned, definitely they are going to add on to the quality of the teaching. But whether any of these components could be a compulsory part of the curriculum, there is a big question mark, because acceptability of all these products need to be debated first. First of all, the awareness. What I can say is that first these products, awareness has to be created. And then these need to be accepted at the various levels, maybe first at the Board of Studies level, then at the Academic Council level. So it's a long way to go. Whether it should be some credit can be given, there are several issues in that. But definitely what my perception is that these products are some kind of add-ons, because we have seen, as far as Rajasthan is concerned, faculty is a big issue. So it does add on. It does add on in the form of remedial kind of teaching and things like that. But how much credit and how do we make it as a component of the evaluation system in the existing curriculum of the university? It really needs a
what about
a lot
the
of
classroom, not just giving credit? Let's say you have a teacher who
and
wants
the
same, answer
questions. Yes, definitely. But see, even in AICT model curriculum, you have a scheme of audit courses. Okay. Right. So that is the first initiation, I think, in kind of non-credit or audit kind of thing, where there are, for example, AICT says that 20% should be given to the humanities course. Now that is not the usually, it is not the part of the curriculum. So if you have these kind of add-ons, I think it could be a great value addition to the technical education. Now what are you asking, madam?
She was asking about flipped classrooms.
One of the ways to get students to actually attend an
audit. I think they can definitely be implemented in the form of pilot project. Let us have an experimentation, let us have this experience. But to make it directly, if you want a suggestion from the university that what is the level of acceptance, needs to be attained. So as a pilot project, definitely these products are to be experimented.
But I think it has to be a phased approach. But no technology, education technology intervention will work if it is not very well integrated with the entire pedagogy. So I think in the end, you have to go slow. I agree with you that do some pilot and stuff. And in the end, this thing has to be completely integrated with the overall delivery. You can't keep it as an add-on. The moment you make it as an add-on, it becomes an add-on load for teacher, add-on load for administrator. It has to be treated as one whole chunk which has all the components of technology also built into it. And the teacher is effectively delivering the same time that he or she would deliver at normal. I think that should be the vision.
Single platform delivery.
Absolutely. And has to be rolled out gradually with taking teachers along, administrators along. That is when it will find right.
Valuable suggestion, madam.
Just 1 minute. Let me close this point. I want to ask you for a clarification. What you're saying is that AICT, in its role as a regulator, can help the acceptance process enormously by saying that, you know, whatever 20% of the courses can be run online. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah.
Huh.
While you write the courses, you are writing some few chapters, at the end of the chapters you are giving reference material.
Mm-hmm.
The best, suppose one thing we can make mandatory from the UGC, IICT is gone, that suppose there is a course say on compiler construction design, if there is any content developed by NPTEL or anything, there should be mentioned there, that's all. That include that, they have referred that. Questions may come from that. See, once you list up this stuff,
references. Online materials.
Yes.
You're saying references.
Yeah. I think that could be a.
That is the best solution.
And
that is the best. That is the only way you can impose.
Yes.
Directly, indirectly, you can impose that.
Yes.
That is the first. The online courses developed by NPTEL or anybody can be given as a reference in the syllabus.
Exactly.
Or is a reference textbook. The UGC can tell that you should have this material close. Then once it's given as a reference material, then that may come in the examination. So they will definitely go through it.
Exactly, that is what the pedagogy project is doing. They give you the structure. And they give you the reference material that these are the lectures you should be reading, and so that you have the learning
outcome. 30% of the
that you have
this is the first initiative we can take to roll out these equipment.
If anybody has any last comments, Mr. Pradeep.
No, we'll assemble now.
Later.
We'll just sit and, you know, try to find out what needs to be written in the report. So maybe 5-10 minutes later.
Just now?
Yeah.
Would you like to guide that discussion? Okay. So Satish, do you want to say some of the main things that you've captured, not the details?
Sure. I think we started out discussing question one, the trade-off between coverage versus effective use. There was some news, like industry view, that e-learning has not worked because of a few reasons like student stickiness, etc.
Mm-hmm.
There was an academic perspective on why existing technologies like EduSat, etc. was not really going through because there was not enough buy-in, you know, from the local administration and the faculty, etc. There was a comment from the Sakshar perspective, the teacher plays a very critical role. Teacher training becomes a very important parameter in the whole thing. And there is a repeated thread which has been coming in saying that any technology interventions like these should be made as part of the curriculum, you know, in different ways possible to make really adoption, you know.
To increase adoption.
Yeah. Then there was a concern raised as to who is the exact target audience for these technologies. Is it existing classroom students who are already in the classroom, or is it a new set of students who are right now not being touched by the current academic landscape? So there was some response to that, saying that, for example, one scenario could be people like ICFI students who are taking, you know, correspondence courses or open university students could now be brought as part of the ecosystem by these things. Also, things like remedial teaching can be done, you know, through use of online technologies. Then the discussion was on the question 3, 4, 5, which I think Anna initiated, where the idea was how do you increase scale and increase quality of teaching. So there was a proposal of using a filtering process by an exam with a very relatively low bar for qualification, and then use synchronous modes of teaching to the filtered set of students.
We never did the poll on that, so we don't really know.
There was a concern raised that any filtering goes against the basic philosophy of MOOCs and online teaching, etc. And there was also a point about the need to have adequate mechanisms for student motivation and engagement. like certification, course credits, again the same thing repeated.
Mm-hmm.
Also engagement via social media to make sure there is interest and dialogue. There was another discussion on question number two, which is there was a point made that it is difficult to get the perfect content, you know, available right at the start, and the point was made by him saying that let's get the delivery mechanisms in place and let's worry about what goes in and how will that, you know, impact outcomes later. But I think we should first make recommendations or think about what kind of delivery systems need or will make sense in the current scenario. Experiments like ETH, etc.
I mean,
will
rather emphasize institutionalization, improve the delivery mechanism.
Yeah, experiments, you know, on delivery channels need to be made and corrections can be made as we go along on content.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Other discussion threads, how do we get all the content that is there between government and all private entities to be made available in the relevant way to students? Sakshat, this would be an attempt to be a consolidated system. Yes, but for all content creation, mandating
email and he's made some good notes.
Yeah, very good notes. Yeah.
For all content creation, mandating processes like indexing and meta tagging will be key factors.
Yeah.
Community rating mechanisms will also play an important role to determine hierarchy of content structure. Given Indian unique circumstances, the dynamic between universities and colleges with their limited autonomy plays a key role in successful adoption of online education. Consistent certification and recognition mechanisms between online and classroom teaching audiences will also play a role. Online methodologies probably should be implemented in a phased approach in the university system, given the, you know, challenges and apprehensions from faculty especially. Integration within the curriculum will make it easier to get buy-in from teachers, students and administrators.
Can we also think of maybe some sort of a consortium where we pool together, that resources are there, like we have for Indus Consortium or like that. Can we think in that direction so that, I mean, whatever the efforts are that are happening, we can pool together?
NMEICT
is a mission. It will not continue. How do you sustain it for lifelong? So you need to institutionalize that. So you have to have a sustainable model also in place. That is very important. So, I mean, just, I was wondering when the discussion came back, I mean, going on. So, let's have an opinion on that quick.
You mean for creation of content?
No, not creation. It's happening, delivery.
Consortium for delivery of content?
Delivery, I mean, okay, offering program.
Like
the meta-university kind of a philosophy.
Kind of crowdsourcing, key kind of a thing, where the inputs that come should also get incorporated.
I think there is a need for an industry academia type of body also to push best practices, what is working abroad, what is working here, what you can reuse, what you can't. Now, I think there is a need for such bodies.
But isn't
Sakshat
an organization which keeps on connecting with the industry?
Sakshat is a portal.
It's just a portal. It's not a
portal.
It's a project.
It's a repository.
And NMEICT has a finite time.
And it's just a repository.
So there's a very important point she's making.
It's definitely a need for a body.
It's a repository.
There is a need for
So there is a very important point she is making, that there you have to ensure continuity of that, and you need some people whose job it is to ensure continuity, and I think that's an important recommendation.
We had this mishap, such a beautiful program is gone.
Such nice things come up and they
vanish.
All right, so with your permission, shall we close it for now and then we'll sit down and tie up all the inputs?
Okay.
Sadish, we give you a hand actually. Thank you very much for capturing impossible discussions.
That's a historian. Yeah, very good.